Thank you for the introduction. A small correction, we haven't really made the 3D footprinter yet. We're doing experiments in that area, but as you will see at the end of my talk, we're not there yet, and neither is the rest of the, well, research groups that are working in this area. So indeed, the 3D footprinter. First of all, a small definition. What is a 3D footprinter, just so that we're all on the same page? In my opinion, a 3D footprinter is a device that can produce any kind, ideally any kind of food product, starting from a series of basic ingredients using printing or other deposition technologies. So it's clear to it's good to remember that it doesn't have to be printing always. Keep this in mind when you look at this presentation. So first of all, the big question, why would you need to print food? In my opinion, there's several reasons why this is the case. First of all, and that's sort of the topic of why we're here today in this session, there's the global population increase, and as a result, there's an increased demand for food. Now, at the moment, a lot of farms still look like this, especially in the Netherlands, cows happily walking outside, eating grass, and ultimately giving us these kind of food products, except if you're vegetarian, I guess, which I'm not, definitely. So this is what it's like now. However, people envision that in the future, and that might not take that long, a lot of farms will actually look like this. They would be farming algae, and why is that? Because algae are rich in all sorts of nutrients, proteins, omega-3 fatty acid, you name it. There's a lot of things that you can take from algae. And the nice thing about algae is that they grow very fast, etc. So actually, the whole production cycle and the carbon footprint, water footprint that you need for this kind of nutrients is much, much lower than it is for cows, which is a particularly bad way to make a protein food, actually. So algae are nice, but of course, they don't make steaks. And what you risk that you end up with food-wise is something like this, which is probably very healthy, but not very appetizing. So at that point in time, some kind of processing technology that allows you to turn these kind of ingredients into something like this, which, especially in the Netherlands, we all like, although some people might not like satay sauce, but it's a very popular dish in the Netherlands. If you have some kind of technology that can do that, then it would be very welcome. Now, a second reason why you would like to print food is the fact that it can truly lead to personalized food. Personalized food printers can make the dish that is right for you. And why would you want that? Well, there's several reasons. Can be because of your age. Here's an old person and a very young person. Both of them, coincidentally, don't have any teeth to chew their food with. But still, you know, the type of food that they should eat is very different based on their age. Another reason why you want some kind of personalized food is because of your health status. Now, it can be that it's because you're pregnant, can be that it's because you're ill. But in all these cases, the kind of nutrients and the amount of nutrients that you require is very, very different. Another reason why you would want to have personalized foods, it can be based on the kind of activities you do, sports or otherwise. And these kind of athletes in both these very different sports have very special diets, but as you can imagine, these diets are very, very different. Now, the third reason for wanting to print food is convenience. Let's be honest, more and more people are eating these kind of microwave dinners, and the reason for that is that they're either too busy or they think that they're too busy. They don't have the time, or they don't make the time to cook a proper meal. And some people are actually no longer capable of cooking properly because, you know, they never cook. So more and more tasks in our houses, and some of the previous speakers already talked about that, are being taken over by robotic or other electronic devices, such as this robotic vacuum cleaner. So why not have a robotic chef in our house, somebody like this guy, that welcomes you home when you arrive from a hard day at work and then presents you with a special meal that is according to your liking and portion size, which in this case is pretty close to what I eat. The fourth reason is that printing food could be fun, and this is actually my personal favorite. I like to cook, I like to play with food, and any kind of device, instrument, whatever, that allows you to play more with your food, which your parents told you not to do, but still, any kind of device that allows you to do that, to be creative with food, I welcome it. And for those people that are paying attention, these things look like cakes, but they're actually earrings, which I think is a nice way to illustrate that fun is indeed there in food. So if you had a food printer, what could you do? You could print this kind of dishes. It's mashed potatoes, there's a steak, there's a salad, all very well, but it's stuff that you know already. It's mesh again, as I put down on there. So if I had a food printer, I would not stick to regular food dishes. Rather, I would try and invent new kinds of food, substances, food dishes that have never been made before and that cannot be made before because the technology was not there. It can be that we're talking about new kinds of flavors, new kinds of structures, textures, or shapes, and combinations of this. So I have absolutely no idea what these kind of food products are and what they would taste like, but I'd love to try them. However, we cannot make them yet, and that's why we really need a food printer, I think. So what can we say about the commercial status about food printing? We've seen the reasons why we would like to do it, but how far are we? And I have to say, we're not that far. If you Google food printing, most of the hits that you find will come down to this, which is actually a 2D image printed on top of a cake. It is food printing, yes, because food-grade inks are being used and it uses printing technology, but it's not really what we want. It's only 2D. We really want to go 3D. So the next... Wow. Somebody can turn the sound down, please. The next best thing, thanks. Wow, that was really loud. Next best thing is this. It's a technology developed by a Dutch company called Foodjet, former TNO colleague, by the way, who has developed some technology that can really put down significant amounts of food on top of another food object, as you saw with the pizza sauce on the pizza bottom. This can be done for other materials as well, as is illustrated here. Here the block represents a cake or a piece of bread or whatever food product. And here you see that some kind of icing material, which is used on cakes very often, is deposited here in the logo of Foodjet. This can be done for a lot of different materials and a lot of different shapes, obviously. But what is important here is that you're really depositing significant amounts of food. So this is already 2.5D food printing. And if you would put it multi-layer, then you would really go to 3D food printing. Another technology that recently made it to the market is this technology. It's from a company called Shock Edge, a spin-off of the University of Exeter, which put in the market the first real 3D chocolate printer, which of course is something that people can relate to. Printing chocolate is not scary, it's not Frankenstein food, it's nice. Chocolate doesn't grow on trees in the shapes that we eat it. So there's no threat to, you know, public perception on food. So this is a nice application. It is, however, only available for chocolate, and it's still relatively slow, but it's a nice start, and it's a nice way to get, you know, market introduction and customer awareness, etc., and realization that this is coming with respect to the food printer. However, the real 3D food printers that can basically print anything, where are they? They're not there. All we have at the moment is these kind of design concepts from various companies and organizations, and they look very cool, but they're no more than computer drawings. And what they all do have in common is that they have some kind of cartridge of raw ingredients going in on the top, and the food dish that is being printed or otherwise made coming out on the bottom. However, the part in the middle, the technological part, so which technology do you have in there to print the food, that is not specified, and nobody really knows what to use yet. And why is that? It's very simple. It's because food is very complex. If we look at all these kinds of foods that are shown here, then all of them have some kind of structural properties, like for example the airy structure of the whipped cream and the cake, or the bundled protein fibers in the steak. And those kind of structures, when you eat them, you realize, this is whipped cream, or this is a steak. And on top of that, there's of course the other factors, the flavor, the color, the smell, etc. Whole list of factors, which are all different for each food product. And if you want to have a food printer, then it's very challenging to replicate all these kind of properties with one type of technology. So the big question now is, how can we ever print food? And for that, I would like to look into the future, and it's been mentioned before, Star Trek. And why would I like to look at Star Trek? The reason is that in Star Trek, there is already some kind of food printing technology mentioned. Now, there's different series of Star Trek. For Trekkies like me, you probably might know. 24th Century Technology, in one of the later series, they have a food replicator, in which food is prepared by rearranging subatomic particles to form molecules, and then those molecules are rearranged to form the food object. Well, I think we can all agree that that's a little bit too challenging for our 21st century technology. However, if we look at the older series, which were broadcasted in the 1960s, they play in the 23rd century, and what they have there is a food synthesizer, in which food is prepared in high-speed equipment and moved to a food slot via a small turbolift technology. Let's forget about the turbolift technology. We don't really need it. It's just to move the food from where it's being prepared to that food slot. So apparently what we need is high-speed equipment. What is this high-speed equipment? In today's terminology, this could be rapid manufacturing technology. For those of you who are not familiar with that, it's also known as 3D printing, which matches nicely with what we're looking for in a 3D food printer. And actually, it's a variety of technologies, several of which are listed here, and they have in common that they all build objects without using some kind of mold or whatever, directly from a computer drawing in a layer-by-layer fashion. The nice thing is, like I said, there's a whole list of technologies that are out there, all with different technological principles and capable of working with different kinds of materials. Those have, however, not really been used for food, because traditionally they were being used for plastics, polymers, metals, things like that. However, can we use these technologies that have been around for a long time already and start to apply them for food? And several people have indeed tried to do that, and successfully in some cases. So here's a technology which is called FDM. I won't go into what all the abbreviations mean. What this basically does, it's a syringe filled with some kind of mashed up food product, or a puree, or a batter, and you basically squeeze it out into a certain shape. However, in this case, of course, it's being done by a computer in a very precise manner. And then you can make these interesting food shapes, which are shown here, and don't want to go into all the details, but the bottom one is nice. There they use two different kinds of cake batter, a dark one, a brown one, as you see there, and a normal one. And in the end, you can make a cake with a shape on the inside. So if you cut through the cake, there's the letter C of Cornell University who did this. And that's a nice food object that you cannot really make with normal production methods. So FDM works. Another thing that we did with FDM ourselves is make a wine gum. Well, if you look at it, it feels like a wine gum, it's rubbery, it tastes like a wine gum. One of my colleagues who's in the audience actually tasted it, he had the courage to taste it, and he's still alive, which is important to mention. However, the shape, as you can see, is completely different. He put up his hand, very brave. The shape is very different from a normal wine gum. Of course, I'm a scientist, I'm not an artist like the previous two speakers, so we have this boring tubular shape. I'm sure all the artists here could think of much nicer shapes, but you can do it. Another one is this one, which can make a personalized chocolate nut snack. It has a chocolate dispenser, it has a nut dispenser. If you like more nuts, it puts in more nuts. If you like less nuts, etc. You get the idea. But this is a nice idea. It's a concept, of course, but it works. I said already, there are several technologies. Here's another one called SLS. It uses laser sintering, so it shines with the laser on top of a powder. And there where the laser hits the powder fuses together. Now if you do this layer after layer after layer, so you put a new layer of powder every time and again hit it with the laser, then you can build up 3D objects. This has been done a long time ago. However, we were the first one, as far as we know, to do it with Nesquik powder. And we made these kind of shapes. Of course, a T&O logo. Sorry for that. And these other interesting shapes, which I think are actually a lot nicer, two chain links interconnected like this, and they can move freely. And the nice thing is that you cannot really make those kind of things with other production technologies, because to make those two chain links interlinked, you would need to do it by hand, actually. The principle of shining with a laser or some kind of light source on a material to make it solid can also be used for liquids. And we did it here for egg white protein. So this is basically the white of your egg. You take away the yolk, you keep the white. You put it in a petri dish as we did, and you shine on it with a laser and you write a certain pattern. And there where you write the pattern, the egg cooks and becomes solid, similar to frying an egg in your pan. We made a little square as a first experiment, and then, of course, again, T&O logo, sorry. It's actually six layers thick, the T&O logo, so if you continue building like that, you can really make a 3D object. We actually recently made world's smallest fried egg, as you can see here. This is real cooked egg white. A scale is about 2 centimeters from left to right, and yeah, to make a real nerdy joke, the smallest fried egg is actually there. It's the decimal point, with a size of about 300 microns, sorry for that. So I've showed you now some technologies and materials. One of the other questions that you have to be able to answer is, can you also produce at the right speed and the right production scale? And that is also something that's being looked at. What you see here is state of the art with respect to rapid manufacturing. It's a carousel of 100 building platforms that actually moves underneath several printing heads that can deposit material on them. You can have one printing head, you can have several printing heads, you can have all sorts of other processing steps, and they can move at a very high speed as you see now. It goes at about 2 meters per second. So what is the principle here? As I said, you have these building platforms, different kind of printer heads moving on top of the building platforms and depositing material layer after layer. And as I said, there can be different materials, and you can also make a different object per platform. And building times at the moment are down to actually a couple of seconds per object. We have not used it for food yet, but we plan to do so in the next half year or so when we have a project starting. So I've shown you now what we can do at the moment. And obviously, as I said at the beginning, the food printer is not there yet, but we're working in that direction. But let's forget that for a minute, and let's just imagine that we would have a personalized food printer in your home. This is the personalized food printer of Bob. Bob is at work, and Bob takes out his smartphone, which I think almost everybody in the room here has. I noticed during the meeting today. And Bob on his smartphone selects his food printer app. It can be that he has a single app. It can be that he is a foodie and he has several apps, one for Japanese food, one for Italian, one for sweets or something like that. So he selects his Italian food app and then picks out a dish. The food printer then receives a message from Bob. That's Bob. And it says, okay, Bob has selected a recipe. It goes to the recipe database, takes out the recipe that Bob wants. However, then a warning sign appears. And the reason is that Bob, unfortunately, he has a risk of heart disease, and he's been putting on quite a lot of kilos over the last couple of years. So the food printer now says, look, Bob, I'll give you the food you want, but instead of 100% portion, I'll give you an 80% portion because you should watch your weight. So the food printer then approves the recipe and says, okay, I'll store the recipe with the reduced caloric content. And then the food printer starts to register where Bob is. It sees that Bob is actually in his car. And he sees that Bob is there driving from Amsterdam to Eindhoven, where we are now, and moving along in his car, etc. And at some point, another warning signal appears in the food printer. And that's because it's detected that there is some kind of traffic jam ahead of on the roads where Bob's going, and it's around in Bos, which, as we know, is always a problem. So it then adjusts the time at which the food has to be ready, also stores that, and then waits for Bob to come home. And when Bob comes home, there's some kind of beeping signal. We'll still have beeping signals in the future, I assume. And then the food printer opens, and there it is, the plate of food that Bob wanted, a nice plate of lasagna. And actually, the food printer has added a bit of salad on the side because Bob really should eat more greens, it says. So what do you think? Is this too futuristic a scenario or not? I personally think that the people watching the original Star Trek series in the 1960s would have said, oh, this is all science fiction. But I think that most of you will agree that a lot of the technologies that were in this scenario, the apps, the wireless internet, etc., they're already there. So I think it's only a matter of time before such a food printer also makes it to the market. And then everybody will have something like this, or looking slightly less 60s, in our homes. But before I end, there's one more question I would like to ask you. If you indeed had such a food printer in your home, what would you print? Thank you.